Good morning.
Good morning.
And peace to you. Welcome to First United Methodist Church of Roseville, a place where we do our absolute best to live into the gospel message of love as a community, right? A community that is committed to offering hope to this world. Today's a good day, right? All right, so we don't usually do this, but within the black church tradition, within the black church tradition, sometimes a pastor would say, you're going to have to pray me through this. I thought I was good. I thought. Today's a day that God has made, therefore. Amen. We are rejoicing and being glad for multiple reasons. Some very personal, obviously. For instance, for me, I find joy in that the baseball season is in full swing. The Yankees will be in town next week, and I'll be there regardless. If the Yanks are in town, I'm out. I put up my, peace sign, and I'm gone. But I'm really excited because this week I'm going with my family. And we're catching games on both Tuesdays and Wednesday. It'll be the first time we do this as a family of four. And so, train up a child in the way they shall go. I'm also rejoicing and being glad because the last Friday was absolutely special. It was beautiful to be able to see just a representation of so much diversity within our communities. We had representative within the Latino, Hispanic community, but then we had a whole bunch of people from the Ukrainians that we've reached out to. They were in the mix. There was a family from Nepal who was there as well. Kids were out there playing in the, in the water and the slides and all these things, and it was just an absolute beautiful demonstration of what God can do as community. And lastly, though this is the last day that I'll be before you as pastor, I am rejoicing and being glad in you. Because of you, my community, my church, and the joy that we have spent together over the last 3.5 years or so. So yes, today is a day that God has made and prepared for us to share, so let us do just that. Let's get started. If you're willing and able, I invite you to please stand as Jan leads us in our call to worship.
We gather this morning with joy in our hearts.
We enter this house with praise on our lips.
We are secured in our knowing that God is with us.
Morning by morning, we are blessed with new mercies.
We are strengthened during times of transitions and change.
In all things, God's great faithfulness ever surrounds us.
Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture this morning comes from the 20th chapter in the book of Acts, verses 13 to 24 and 36 to 37. We went on ahead to the ship and sailed for Assos, where we were going to take Paul aboard. He had made this arrangement because he was going there on foot. When he met us at Assos, we took him aboard and went on to Mytilene. The next day, we set sail from there and arrived off Chios. The day after that, we crossed over to Samos, and on the following day, arrived at Miletus. Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus to avoid spending time in the province of Asia, for he was in a hurry to reach Jerusalem, if possible, by the day of Pentecost. From Miletus, Paul sent to Ephesus for the elders of the church. When they arrived, he said to them, "You know how I lived the whole time I was with you. From the first day I came into the province of Asia, I served the Lord with great humility and with tears, and in the midst of severe testing by the plots of my Jewish opponents. You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace." When Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Let us pray. Dear God, in these brief moments, I pray that you will open our hearts so that we may receive that which you have for us to receive. And as always, may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, who is both our rock and redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
So as you can see, the scripture refers to the Apostle Paul. But I couldn't find any good jokes about Paul to start off, you know. So finally, as I was Googling different sites, it occurred to me that Moses must have been an early pioneering tech genius. You know why? Because he was the first to download something from a cloud onto two tablets. How's that? That's a good one? Y'all like that one? First, download something from a cloud into two tablets. Yeah, just see. All right. Let's go back to Paul. Now, you've been with me for 3.5 years, and you know probably that I don't usually preach from Paul. It's not that he doesn't have a dynamic story. In fact, many of you maybe resonate with his that dramatic conversion story where he was literally blinded by the light on the road to Damascus. His role in the development and the theology of the early church is unparalleled, but personal prerogatives does not always lead me to him, right? Ironically, on this day, I found his experience as recorded in the 20th chapter of Acts very instructive. Paul is saying goodbye to the elders of Ephesus. And like my time in Roseville, Paul spent around about 3-ish pivotal years with them. And now he's heading to Jerusalem. He's heading to a new chapter. And he wants to meet with them one last time. So he calls them, however they're called, sent out messages to meet him at Miletus. If for context, Miletus is this port city. And it was about a day's travel from Ephesus, which was the capital city of the Roman province. Now, Ephesus was a significant center of trade, located by this large harbor, and many roads intersected at Ephesus, and other cities kind of poured in there. So Ephesus was known as this cosmopolitan town, and it had this large amphitheater, the largest in the world at the time. Had all these great landmarks too, including the Temple of Artemis or the Temple of Diana. And it was this prime site where people from all around the world gathered. And on Paul's second missionary journey, around about AD 52, he visited there in Ephesus and planted a church. And on Paul's third missionary journey, Paul spent again about 3 years teaching in the city, writing, and just being within the community. And during that time, they got close. And so in AD 57, when the trail got hot for Paul, and the authorities were chasing him, and as you heard in the scripture, Paul was moving from city to city, right? He had to get to Jerusalem. And on the way to Jerusalem was an uncertain future. But he calls for the Ephesus leaders to meet him, again, a day's journey away from the nearby port city of Miletus. There, he makes his farewell address. And though, my opinion, Paul can sometimes be prone to boasting, you know, it's good, but he's very clear in what his final words were, including his philosophy of ministry, reveling in what they accomplished in creating a vital church, and explaining how all the sacrifices, including the fact that he was basically on the run at this point, was all worth it in the end. Paul says, "I consider my life worth nothing. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace." There's this warm and mutual love for each other that is evident in this scene. And Luke, right, who's the author of Acts, beautifully records this final conversation and then adds this little tidbit at the end. When Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced and kissed him. This scene is particularly moving when I think about the fact that Paul knew that this was most likely the last time that they would meet. Beyond Jerusalem, I believe that he knew that the events that would lead to his demise were at nigh. And history shows that Paul's ultimate destination and fate would play out in the ancient Rome, which was the seat of the Roman power. My family and I were there last September. It was incredibly moving, and it's beautiful there in Italy. Amiamo Italia. I love Italy, we say, right? And we did all the things that tourists do, including going to the Colosseum, as you can see. Pictures were taken in abundance, and the engineering to this day, it causes one to marvel. And about the time that Paul was sent to Rome to be on trial, the foundations of that building that you see were probably being set. So it was around about the same time. Paul would have also been familiar with this area that you see, sometimes called the Hills of Rome or the Seven Hills of Rome, the places of palaces and temples and civic buildings and cobbled streets. Here is where the people gathered. From the patricians to the plebeians, folks would have whispered about this most likely bald dude from Tarsus on trial for talking some talk about this Jewish teacher executed in Judea, but somehow resurrected as a living Christ. And on our tour, the guide offered three throwaway sentences as we passed this site. I, being who I am, probably the only person who lingered to take pictures, notice that this was the maritime jail, the place where both Peter and Paul is said to have been imprisoned before eventually going to their own respective executions. I wondered, as I was going through these scriptures, Just how much, while in that dank and musty cell, his heart might have been warmed with the memory of the joyful tears and the prayers and the hugs and the love that he experienced from those Ephesian elders in Miletus. You know, saying goodbye is not easy. It really isn't. But it is a necessary and healthy touchstone event that marks a moment in time. And no, I am nowhere near as prolific or as energetic or as inspired as the Apostle Paul. Far from it. And no, I'm not facing the type of danger that he faced that would eventually lead him into a Roman jail cell. And no, this is not as tragic as the community in Ephesians faced, as they kind of knew that this was the last time that they will ever see Paul again. In contrast, I'll be about 20 miles down the road, down the I-80, or as they say in California, the 80. You know, I don't know why they put the in front of it. You know, I-80. However, like Paul, I know the difficulty in having to say goodbye and all of the mixed feelings that accompany that act. By the way, you might have noticed, or probably didn't escape from you, that I was rocking this beautiful pinstripe Yankees jersey in Rome. When I noticed that last week, I thought of the great Yankee Henry Louis Gerigh, or you guys know him as Lou Gehrig. Fun fact, and this is for you, Dave. His professional game, his first professional game, were played in a team called the Senators, which is in my hometown of Hartford, Connecticut. Did you know that? Lou Gehrig was in play. Yeah. This was 102 years ago, when our own Miss Hazel was but a toddler. Gehrig went on to have this stellar career in the Bronx, partnering with this little-known guy from Baltimore nicknamed the Babe. Whoever, I don't know who that was, right? He became known as the Iron Horse because of his reliability, amassing 7 World Championships and World Series Championships over his 17-year career and a career batting average of .340. So he's pretty good. And despite that, many people remember him for how his career ended, as he suffered with this incurable neuromuscular disease named ALS, which later became known as Lou Gehrig's disease. Famously, on July 4th, 1939, at the age of 36, just 2 years before his death, so he was young, Lou Gehrig offered one of the most famous farewells in history. Some newspapers called it baseball's Gettysburg Address. It was delivered at his retirement celebration and ceremony to a sold-out crowd at Yankee Stadium. Now, having always avoided kind of public attention, Gehrig did not want to speak. The crowd was chanting for him to say something. So reluctantly, but movingly, he steps up to the mics and begins to say his goodbye by saying, "Fans, for the past 2 weeks, you've been reading about me catching a bad break. But today, I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth." So what does this mean for us today? Let me say, in the same way I am far from Paul, I can confidently say that I am no Lou Gehrig either. And yet, like them, I am confronted with the task of saying goodbye, a farewell to the people that I love. But like Paul, I am comforted by two things. First, the certainty of the love that we shared as a community. And secondly, the fact that we did our best to testify and live into the gospel message of love as a what? As a community committed to offering hope to this world. And because of that, this morning I feel the feelings that Gehrig must have felt on that long time ago baseball diamond, that I'm the luckiest man on the face of this earth. So I consider myself lucky because ever since I pulled up to the little white church with the red doors on the corner of Washington Boulevard and Church Street, I believe this was in September of 2019, and took all these pictures with the elevator still being in construction, I knew somehow that my life was going to change. I consider myself lucky because when I saw my name chiseled into that wood at the bottom of the sign, I felt the honor of being in a long line of pastors and leaders who came before me who did their best to serve this church and its community. I consider myself lucky because from the day I was installed in November of 2019, I felt that this place was a place of home for my ministry and a place where I can hone my ministerial gifts and learn what it means to be a Methodist minister. It was also the time that Kathleen sat beside me right up there in love, becoming a pillar of personal support from that first day till now. And I consider myself lucky because when I came into my office for that first time and sat down in the chairs, I knew that this would be a place of home, not just for me, but for my family. And I consider myself lucky because even to this day, I am still warmed by the memory of us singing carols by candlelight while circling this sanctuary during our first Christmas Eve service. And I consider myself lucky because even when the pandemic hit, just 4 months after I arrived, we still found a way to record and disseminate a worship service experience. And I was able to form a lasting friendship with Ray and Beth, who offered their time and love by recording those services week by week. I consider myself lucky because I was able to meet all of you, and even people like Don, who with steadiness and love gives of his time, his treasure, his talents without asking for anything in return. The same can be said of other people like Connie and Nancy and Dennis and John and Nancy B and others who put up with me with patience and love. And I consider myself lucky because even when the pandemic hit, we, like I said, gathered together. And under Sandy Williams' prompting, we committed to coming together in parks and schools while even celebrating the birthday of our beloved Hazel, who then turned 102 years young. Y'all remember that? Yeah. I consider myself lucky because of all of what Fourth Friday has become and what it means to so many people and so many organizations, turning First Church into a community center that centers the community in love and in hope. And I consider myself lucky because despite all the difficult things we encounter, we still have time to have fun. And when I forget to have fun, I have folks like Ruth Ann and Elba who will bring levity and joy. I consider myself lucky because I believe we truly embody the idea of open minds and open hearts and open doors, and that we are dedicated to the idea of us doing as much good as we can for as many people as possible. I consider myself lucky to have been nurtured by Jan and Dave, even Seacrest, who with, again, consistency, offered a prayer service experience in the middle of the week, Tuesday at 6, and facilitated a place of balm and calm for my soul and for others. I consider myself lucky for the countless nights that I entered into this very sanctuary just to get away and to pray. And I also remember how I had that same sense of sanctuary when I visited Grace and Larry's house and was received with hospitality and care. I consider myself lucky because this was a place where I was able to celebrate both the completion of my doctorate and my ordination as a Methodist elder. And I'm eternally grateful for the ways this church encouraged me to grow both personally and professionally. I consider myself lucky because, speaking of growth, this is where you welcomed our growing family, loving on both Niara and Chloe, and making it easier for Chloe to have a sense of home. You reflected that love that was needed, that what could have been a very difficult situation, just a bit easier. And I consider myself lucky because, again, despite all the serious times we had, I had a lot of fun. Like, do you remember this impromptu photo shoot we had, Nancy, in my office? You know, right now I don't have a lot of words. And there's no need to offer deep, profound words of farewell. I just want you to stay a place of welcome and love for all people, to do good and to stay in love with God and with each other. In doing so, you will make the next pastor feel just as lucky as I feel right now. You know, in closing, one of my favorite songs is one recorded by the Jackson Five, written and performed in, I believe, 1971, about 4 years before I was even born. This popular song featured a then 11-year-old Michael Jackson singing. And it was one of the group's most successful songs, and the title is Never Can Say Goodbye. Let's hear just a little bit of it right now. Never can say that song was on repeat as I wrote this last sermon. Never say goodbye, never can I say goodbye. Its refrain tapped into this longing that I'm sure Paul must have felt in that last meeting with those Ephesians elders. Feeling that I think Lou Gehrig must have felt when he was saying goodbye. And a feeling that I'm feeling right now that I can never truly say goodbye. Why? Because you will never leave me. I would ever hold you in my heart wherever I go, even if it's to a new church. So since I cannot say goodbye, let me say simply this. Thank you. I love you.
I love you too.
And I'll see you later. The awareness of God's perfect peace, we now sing.